Right on time. Welcome into The Rush with Chuck Garfine from Arizona. Gordon Whitmire must be in Flagstaff because there's snow behind him.
This is Mesa. This is Mesa. Sloan Park. See right over here?
Yeah.
Look, if you look real close, you can see Stroman throwing a bullpen. Right back
Chuck,
here.
You got to hear this. So Gordon and I and Tim Stebbins did our podcast last week.
Yeah.
Gordon decided since he was supposed to be in Arizona, he would play it off until like 15 inches of snow fell off his roof and landed on him during the podcast.
Come on.
Gordon?
That was sand from the desert out in Arizona.
Yeah,
exactly. Do we have video of this?
Oh, we do.
Oh, yeah. Unfortunately, there's video.
I need to see this.
It's so good.
By the way, Gordon, props to you. You look phenomenal. You
can tell I'm getting some sun.
See? You're getting some sun. Yeah. You're short sleeves. Well,
I'm telling
done.
You, I mean, it's so warm here. I couldn't button all the way up. I was sweating.
What's really strange is that it's about 80 degrees where I'm at in Phoenix, and yet in Mesa, where you are theoretically at, it's snowing or has snow on the ground.
Well, no, it just looks that's an optical illusion. It just looks like snow. I'm telling you, they're taking infield right behind me.
Gordon, that is the deep freeze known as the labor negotiations going on right now.
No.
By the way, would you guys like to say hi to Stanley the Manly? He's right there. Okay, let's get into this baseball stuff. Because
Stanley, can you get something done on this labor thing?
Stanley is a baseball guy. He watches games with me, right, buddy? And so today, Gordon, Jesse Rogers, I talked to this morning. I listen to Buster Olney. I'm going to do a podcast with you in a few minutes. It does not sound like things went especially well today. How would you characterize the tenor of the negotiations?
Well, as we talk now, they're still going, is my understanding. But the tenor got worse overnight. I mean, they came back from Saturday and started talking all night. So progress this and progress that. And all of a sudden, we get a word of a threat from MLB saying, we're willing to lose April. We'll just wipe April off the damn schedule if we don't get a deal done tonight. And you look, you guys know as well as I do, if April's gone, May's in play. Because who knows what the urgency is to negotiate at that point with both sides dug in like that. So I think they're making a massive mistake in this. I think for them to think that the casual fan, who barely exists anymore in this game, is going to somehow come back after this is just miscalculating the whole landscape.
Chuck, you're out there. Ostensibly, you were going to cover spring training.
Yeah,
nothing going
planned correctly. I did not plan this very well, but I'm glad I'm here. I'll say this: instead of watching Eloy Jimenez and Tim Anderson on the field, instead, what are we getting as baseball writers, baseball sportscasters, baseball fans? We're getting Rob Manfred and Tony Clark walking in a parking lot. Video of that. That's where the game is right now. I will say this: this is the optimist in me, that this whole thing about that was obviously reported here today that you mentioned, Gordon, about how the owners are willing to just sacrifice the whole first month of the season, and that is maybe true. This is just some downright negotiating going on here, right now. I think this is going to come down to the last minute here today, and we'll see what happens. I'm not confident there's a deal that's going to be made, but I feel all this stuff is leading to one moment at the end of today, that's going to decide this one way or another. Considering the dysfunction that has occurred between these two sides over the last 5 years, this could easily just totally blow up. But the fact that they've spent 8 straight days negotiating says to me, certainly they want to try to get a deal. I can't believe that this is all for show. So I'm hopeful that at the end of this day, they will come to their senses and they will have some sort of agreement or something that could lead to an agreement tomorrow or something like that. If not, I'm with you, Gordon. It could be May, June, who knows?
So I was listening to Buster Olney this morning with KJM, and he said he talked to a very prominent agent in the baseball world. He said, I'm going to repeat again what I told you guys recently, and I relayed this to Gordon on our podcast. He said, I called my clients at Christmas. I said, hey, Chuck, Gordon, Merry Christmas. I'm also tell you Happy New Year, Happy Valentine's Day, Happy St. Patrick's Day, Happy Easter. I'll see you on Flag Day. There won't be a deal till June.
What day is Flag Day?
June 14th.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that could be. I mean, hey, look, Chuck's an optimist. Yeah, you guys know how optimistic I am. I'm a glass three-quarter full guy all the time, right? No friggin' chance. This thing's going into May. They're not getting something done today. I don't see it. Chuck, I appreciate your optimism, man. And that is how these things work, right? They always come down to the last minute when there's a deadline. But how do you make up the massive ground they have to make up in the amount of time they have to do it when they have barely moved 2 inches on either side in 3 months? Yeah, I mean, just look at the core economic, just look at the luxury tax threshold. They're $30 million apart on that. And that might be the single biggest issue here.
I hear you. But you know what? This is what I come away with. We only know a sliver, I think, of what's really going on behind the scenes. Because isn't it funny that they'll negotiate, if it's what you want to call it that, for hours and hours and hours, and this is what we get? This is the only thing we know? I feel like there's more going on than we meet
the funny thing is, so I feel like Bob Nightingale's pretty tapped in. Mm-hmm. I feel like we all have pretty good sources. But Nightingale, National, Buster, Jesse Rogers doing a great job on the ground in Jupiter. And then John Heyman, pretty tapped in dude. He tweets over the weekend, substantial progress, feel like a possible deal could be erotic. And Zach Britton retweets what he said and went, this is inaccurate. Yeah. I'm like, wow.
Look, I don't think there's that much. I don't think there's that much that we don't know. Broadly speaking, I think we have a pretty good idea of the tone of this. And a pretty good, we're getting very specific stuff about what's being offered on both sides, and nobody's disputing the numbers. So if they're even close to accurate, they're miles and miles and miles apart. No matter what we don't know, we do know that much.
So, Chuck, let me ask you this. I was talking to Jesse this morning, and I said, if I was on the owner's negotiating team, I would say, guys, hold your egos in check for a second. 60%, I think this is a number that Gordon used last week with me, 60% make under $1 million and almost 50% make the league minimum. So guess what? That sounds like a majority of the players to me. Maybe I'm dumb, but that sounds like a majority. So how about we come back to the table, we go, we're going to go to 900,000 on the minimum salary for a major league player.
That's a lot. That's huge.
You got to do this, Cap. You got to run those numbers of how many players that is, and you've got to raise the luxury tax threshold accordingly. Because if you don't, that 900,000 just comes out of somebody else's pocket.
Okay, so you do that, and all of a sudden, 60% of the league who's making 575, 650, 710 goes, I'm in. I'll take that pay raise. Now you have that core group putting a lot of pressure on guys who have made generational wealth going, dude, you're pulling up in your custom Porsche, Max Scherzer. You've made $280 million in your career. Most guys, I believe, on opening day, guys who had 1 day of service time in 2021, I looked this up today, players with at least 1 day of service time in 2021, I believe it was 48% have less than $1 million career earnings. Career. So boost the minimum up where they go, well, how do we say no to that?
Yeah, but let me push back on that just for a minute. You're right. Like a majority of these guys, you know, all of a sudden you get a whole bunch more guys like willing to fight for that point. But Max Scherzer, to your point, is willing to fight for that. Max Scherzer's pulling up in his Porsche, but Max Scherzer's at the table, pounding the table for the players, all the players. He's got his money. He just signed the biggest AAV contract ever, a 3-year deal. He's pounding the table for the guys that aren't making it, that don't have that kind of money, that are coming up behind him. So give him credit. A lot of these guys are doing that.
Listen, Rob Manfred said it would be what? Devastating if they lost regular season games.
He'll have blood on his hands, Chuck.
Yeah, he's got it today, as far as I'm concerned.
He needs to be the white knight. I don't see it happening, but he needs to be the white knight that can save this season and I want to say this game from going off a cliff because I think they will recover, hopefully. But
why?
You think why?
I mean, the hardcore fans will come back. They always do. Any sport.
You know what? Casual fans aren't even paying attention to this, right? Casual, we're paying attention to it.
How many casual fans are left compared to the last time they did this? And by the way, I made this point a day or two ago. Look, the last time they did this, they at least had steroids when they came back. I mean, they had a product to sell that was interesting to watch. They had storylines like Cal Ripken's streak when they came back. Listen, there's no storyline. There's no watchability here. Right. There's nothing for the casual fan here to pay this kind of money for.
I'm not saying there's not going to be damage. What I'm trying to say is that we all think the casual fans are paying so much attention to this. The casual fans I speak to are like, wait, what's going on with baseball? That's all they know.
So my next door neighbor.
I agree.
My next door neighbor, I turned on to baseball. He's from South Africa. And we've gotten him tickets. He's gone to games at both parks. He's like, I really like baseball. It's fun. I saw him today. I go, hey, Rodney, let me ask you a question. Are you going to turn off baseball because of what's going on? And he said, wake me up when the season starts.
That's what everyone says to me. Let me know. They don't give a crap about what we're talking about here. The casual fans, the diehards are like, I need baseball.
So yeah, but me. I still think the casual fan, the crisis is the casual fan. There's fewer and fewer of them.
I think that's more of a 2023 thing when they hopefully make some changes to the game that'll bring casual fans to the ballpark. Maybe. That's my opinion.
Worst thing that ever happened to the game was shifts, analytics. I understand. Yeah. The GM goes, hey, dude, my job is to win baseball games by hook or by crook. And if I can move a guy over or I can go sign Gordon Whitmire, because guess what? He's undervalued and I can get him cheap. And that guy's
I am undervalued.
You are undervalued. So,
yes,
I get it. I understand all of it, but there has to be some measure of fixing the game so the younger generation says, I want to watch that.
Because look at the graphic under us. Can Rob Manfred save baseball season?
Rob Manfred is torpedoing baseball right now. I mean, this is his lockout. Okay, it took him 6 weeks to begin negotiations with the union after he locked out the players. He slow played it ever since. This is on him. It's his side that just said they're going to wipe out April.
Okay, here's another question. Fans are asking if Derek Jeter leaving effective immediately as the CEO, part owner of the Marlins, is there any connection that maybe there's a settlement coming that he doesn't like?
I don't think that's it. The New York Post reported that he's been at loggerheads with the principal owners of that team and that he was misled on how much they might have to spend coming out of the lockout. And now he finds out that it's not going to be the $15 million or more that he thought he had. So that's what he means by my vision and their vision is different. But to that point, I think that relates to all these issues that are surrounding the lockout.
Okay. I'd like to think, by the way, that there are several owners. I don't know this for a fact. This is me theorizing. There are several owners who want to end this lockout.
Steve Cohen does.
Yeah. And is it me? Or is this whole lockout being run by the small market teams? Because
no, I was told by someone who would know today, smaller market, they said
it always is.
Jerry,
it always has been.
Tom Ricketts, they'd sign off right now. Let's go. Yeah. Steve Cohen.
Sign off on what, though, Cap? Sign off on what? Yeah. Sign off on what? Because
whatever it takes to get this thing moving.
But make a deal.
Tampa,
make a
deal. Kansas City, Oakland. They're
Marlins.
Like, we're
Marlins.
Not. The Marlins, where
that's why I brought this up.
It's always about the small market teams. However, even the small market teams, unlike the last time we went through this 25 plus years ago, are making money year over year, the way it's structured now. All of them want status quo, even the big market teams, because they're putting tons of money in their pockets compared to what they have. And their franchises are going through the roof. And consequently, they're able to take on all this cheap debt and buy up the neighborhood. We see it in Chicago on the north side. And so it is driven typically by the small markets. And I think in this case, but I think that there's a lot more of the medium and big market teams that are on board too.
What do you guys say to people like David Sampson who say,
Don't get me started, Cap.
Hold on.
Don't get me started.
I'm not saying I agree with him. I'm just simply
giving you his stuff. Oh, sorry.
David Sampson.
Can I say that?
David Sampson ran the Marlins because his stepdad owned the team.
Yeah.
And he said, these people who think that you just print money owning a major league team, you do when you sell it, but cash flow-wise, you do not.
This is not the 90s anymore. They do it cash flow too. If you don't have cash flow in terms of profits running a major league team these days, that's because you're putting it into something else. Usually something else that's an ancillary investment, maybe under a larger umbrella of your company, but you're using baseball money to expand, you know, we'll say your empire, right? That's what the Ricketts have done with what's that, Hickory Street Partners. Yeah. So, and they're not the only ones. I'm not picking on the Ricketts. They're just our example. Yeah. I mean, this is part of the business model now. And it's just the way the industry is run now. So, you know, you can put a moral value on that, an ethical value on that if you want, but that's just the way it is. So, you know, Sampson can go stick it. He's carrying the water of the owners. And as far as I'm concerned, he has no credibility on this.
I mean, do I have any access to the books? Does anyone have access to the books of these?
We have access to the Braves books.
The Braves. You're right. The Braves.
And what did we find out? They made money during the pandemic.
Yeah.
So, and by the way, we've talked to sources that we've had on various programs. Cap knows this firsthand, who have said, you know, from the outside, I thought they printed money. When I got inside, I realized it's way more than I thought. So when you talk to people that don't have a stake in this and aren't carrying somebody else's water, you realize that. And by the way, you don't have to take my word for it or these sources' words for it. Look at the Forbes valuations. They always underestimate what teams wind up selling for. So usually the valuations out there aren't even close to what reality proves to be.
Gentlemen, have a wonderful rest of your evening. Chuck, enjoy the 80-degree temperatures. Gordon, enjoy wherever the hell 70, you are.
75 over here in Mesa, yeah. Roughly.
I can't believe that snow. It must be that stuff.
It's sand. It's sand.
Yeah.
Hey, is there a lawnmower in that shack behind you? Are you going to mow the lawn later today?
That's the media workroom.
I thought that was Peter Chase's office. Oh, wait.
Oh, man.
That'd be cool, man. Inside baseball right there.
That would be Jason Carr's office.
Jason Carr's. Yes.
There you go.
Yes.
Hey, you guys have a great rest of your night. Best to your wives. Have a wonderful rest of your evening. Hey,
can I send out a prayer here on the Rush that I see both of you here in Arizona very soon for spring training? I can't go into the negotiating room and try to get a deal done. All I can do is go on the Rush and say a prayer for baseball. And
that's right, because we have a dinner to go.
Amen.
I know.
And Gordon's invited too. Come on.
I'll drive on over, Chuck.
Chuck's prayer for baseball. There it is. I'm praying.
You got it. You guys have a great night. Gordon, I'll see you in a few minutes for another edition of the award-winning Cubs Talk podcast.
Yes, it's award-winning.
A lot of awards.
That's it. You got it. Let me get my Emmy for the Cubs Talk podcast right here. Have a wonderful evening, gentlemen.